questions I often get asked as an academic, especially one who studies things like pauses in talk, is, what is it you actually do with that face and that intonation? And obviously, one of the things I'm going to try and start to do today is explain to you, what is it I actually do? But I thought just for a minute I would linger on the question. And the question is one of those things which I would call a first move, produced by someone who is a first mover. And you probably all know people like this in your lives. Those people who ask the question which has got some bite in it, some kind of complaint or some kind of agenda in it. What is it you actually do? It implies things about what you do with your life. And it puts you in a quite a difficult interactional position in terms of what to do next. Because if you go next and make explicit the challenge that seems to be in the question, and say something like, what do you mean, what do I actually do? I wouldn't ask you that question. Then the person who went first might say something back like, I was just asking. It's just an innocent kind of question. God, you're so touchy. I can't say anything right. And all of a sudden, you find yourself as the person who made a victim of the first mover, rather than that first mover being the person who produced an overbearing first turn in the first place. So, I'm going to come back to first movers throughout this talk, and at the end I'm going to try and teach you how to at least have a couple of ways of handling them and also figure out if you are one yourself. But to answer the question, or to start to answer the question, what is it you actually do? I thought I'd share the moment in which my mum suddenly started to understand at least something about what it is that I actually do. And we were driving to see my late grandmother, and who was very old, and my mum started to tell me a story about something that had happened to herself the previous week. And she said, I had a fall. And I said, no, mum, you didn't have a fall. You fell over. You need to own that fall. You're not Nan. You don't have falls. You're not old enough to have falls. There's no point in spending a lot of money on anti-aging face creams if you age yourself in your language and talk yourself decades older. You need to anti-age your language and be someone who falls over and doesn't have falls. And all of a sudden, she started to get that the way you describe yourself and the way we describe other people has consequences for who we are and how we live in the world. And of course, the verbs we use and the language we use and the grammar we use sometimes has really important consequences. So I've done quite a lot of work on police interrogations of suspects. And I've got a case in which the suspect's been arrested for assault, and the police officer is asking the suspect about various things that he may or may not have done to the victim, and he asks the suspect, did you push her to the ground? And the suspect comes back with, she fell to the lawn. And, of course, what you can see here is the sort of push-pull in terms of versions of things, and the suspect is replacing the verb push. You know, how was it that the alleged victim went from vertical to horizontal? Did he push her? Was he the agent of that movement? Or did she fall without him being the cause of that movement? And, of course, the other nice detail change there, that the police officer asks about a fall to the ground, push to the ground, whereas the suspect says a fall to the lawn. Lawn's providing for a relatively softer landing than ground, and therefore any injuries that the victim might have had, you know, probably weren't so bad after all. These are the kinds of things that I get interested in as a conversation analyst. And what I'm going to do in this talk is chop it into two halves. In the first half, I'm going to try and show you in a little bit of detail what it is I actually do. Studying talk in a systematic and scientific kind of way, and then hopefully show you how this kind of scientific and detailed approach to studying interaction can have big payoffs when it comes to understanding professional or workplace encounters. So to start off with then, I'm going to show you the opening few seconds of two ordinary domestic telephone calls. We're going to start with Hyla and Nancy. And Hyla and Nancy are American friends. They are on the phone, and we're going to see their conversation roll out line by line in time with the transcript to allow you to live through the interaction as it actually happens, which is how we experience interaction. What you're going to see is that their turns as they start this conversation are just going to go bounce, 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 bounce. They're going to be quickly moving along their interaction. So here comes Hyla and Nancy having a really familiar kind of conversation that you might have had yourself many times today already.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Fine, how are you?
Okay, that's it so far. You can see that there are also dots and dashes and stuff on the transcript, which is to do with intonation and phonetic information, which I'll point out when it becomes relevant. But for now, you can just see that they sort of bounced along through the interaction. And it turns out when we study hundreds of types of these kinds of encounters, openings of ordinary telephone calls, they have a really systematic structure to them, which you can recognize. So first of all, we have a summons, the phone rings, and an answer. Then we have greetings and identification. You could all hear that Nancy's hi at four was a recognition as well as a greeting, and quite in contrast to her hello at line two, which was an answering hello. And then we have initial inquiries, the how are yous, how are you fine, before you get into the main business of the call. Now, the fact that these openings of telephone calls sort of roll out in this systematic way is going to allow us to see what happens when we get some kind of divergence in the pattern. So next, we're going to scoot over the Atlantic to the UK, and we're going to see Dana and Gordon. And Dana and Gordon, boyfriend and girlfriend, maybe not for much longer, as you'll see. Before Dane has even started to speak, we're going to see that there's trouble ahead in this call. They are students, they're home for the holidays, and here's Dana trying to talk to Gordon.
Hello.
Okay. So, I know as a conversation analyst that there's trouble ahead. And the reason I know this is because at line three, something doesn't happen. What doesn't happen at line three is a return greeting. Instead, there is 7/10 of a second of silence. And that's enough to know trouble ahead. So let's see what is going to unfold. Here's line four. Here's Dana.
Hello.
OK, so she's returning the greeting, but we can see it's delayed. And what she's not going to do next is move into the sort of how are yous. Instead, she's going to become a first mover. Here comes Dana's inserted question.
Where have you been all morning?
Where have you been all morning? We can all recognize that as not an innocent information-seeking question, but a question that's got some bite in it. So, where have you been all morning? I've been trying to get you all morning. I'm your girlfriend. I ought to know where you've been all morning. Now, what can you do when confronted with a first mover? You could say, Gordon could say next, What do you mean you don't own me? What do you mean, where have I been all morning? You could start that, and then you're into some kind of conflict. So instead, another way to handle a first mover is to do this.
Hello.
I'm delighted to hear from you. Gordon is going to just do what Nancy did. Hi. I'm just going to do what comes next in the interaction. Then he's going to add a little detail. Now... ums like this tend to crop up at places in interaction to mark the prior as inapposite or unexpected in some kind of way. So here, Gordon is, first of all, pushing back on the first move with the, hello, I'm just doing what normally happens here. And then, I wasn't really expecting you to ask this question next. Before he answers the question, and here comes the answer to the question.
I've been at a music workshop.
Okay, and now he's going to try and move the conversation along into initial inquiries.
How are you?
Now, if Dana was now happy and satisfied that she now knows where Gordon was all morning and was going to just go, fine, how are you, and bounce back into the kind of normal structure that we might see, we would see that at eight. But instead, we see some silence, this time half a second, so we know there's still trouble in the call. And here comes Dana with the reply, which probably isn't going to be, fine, how are you? Instead, she's going to say,
I'm okay.
Which is quite hearably not fine, and she's not doing the reciprocal, how are you, back to him either. So now Gordon really, it is very hearable that Dana is not fine, there is trouble ahead and problems, and she wants to have that conversation, and he could ask her at 10, but instead he says,
good.
So Gordon is really pushing back here on Dana's project. Dana's got a project here, which is to have a conversation with Gordon about some trouble, and Gordon's got a project, which is to not go there with Dana. Okay, so I want you to try and think of our encounters that we have as being like a racetrack, with a landscape and a distinct kind of architecture. So we start at the beginning of the race with our recipient or recipient, and along the way, we proceed along the racetrack, completing projects of various kinds, as we've just seen Hyla and Nancy and Dana and Gordon do. So if you just think about your everyday encounters, there are lots of different types of racetracks. So there might be the telephone calls that you have with a service, they might be doctor-patient conversations, they might be first dates, they might be the conversation you have in the checkout at the supermarket. But all of those things will have a distinct landscape to them, and projects along the way, so greetings and questions and answers and requests and offers and flirts and assessments and stories and partings. And what we've seen so far is that Hyla and Nancy are kind of moving smoothly, progressing around their racetrack, whereas Dana and Gordon are kind of on the rumble strip at the side of the racetrack, kind of bumping along like this, and they may or may not get smoothly progressing around their racetrack ever again. Okay, so conversation analysis then, what do we do? What we do is record hundreds of examples of the same type of encounter. And then what we do is take those recordings and transcribe them in a lot of forensic and linguistic, phonetic kind of detail, and then look at the entire landscape of the encounter to establish the component activities that comprise it. Now, if we can see from Dana and Gordon's call that before Dana's even spoken, after that 7/10 of a second of silence, that there is going to be a problem in that encounter, then we can start to see that there might be a really big payoff to looking at professional encounters, workplace encounters, to try and identify what is working and not working in those encounters. So I've done lots of work on things like police interrogations of suspects, commercial sales calls, and a whole bunch of other kinds of workplace encounters. But I'm going to show you an example now, just one example, of the power of conversation analysis to identify things that may work or may not work in encounters. And the setting is one that's probably going to be unfamiliar to you, which is good because it puts you in the position of the person who's being talked at in this telephone call. So the call is from a big collection of recordings that I've got of initial inquiries into community mediation services. And these are services that exist to try and help people who've got a neighbour dispute. This is a really hard sell for a mediation service who, first of all, is not the go-to service for someone with a dispute. It's an unknown service, and they're basically talking to somebody who has already phoned another organisation, and that organisation's got some kind of bite that mediation services don't have. So, zooming back and thinking about the sort of racetrack and the landscape of these initial inquiries, one of the projects that we're going to zoom in on is the point at which the mediator starts to explain what it is that mediation is and can offer. And it turns out, when you look at hundreds of instances of these explanations, that there's basically two main ways in which the explanation happens. One way nudges the client, the caller, towards being a client, nudges them towards being a yes. And the other way leads you almost immediately to the end of the race. So I'm going to show you an example of a mediator explaining the service to a prospective client.
What we do as a mediation service, we help people sort out their own differences. So we wouldn't take sides, we wouldn't try and decide who's right or wrong, but would try to help you both sort out the differences between you.
Here we have the explanation, and these sorts of materials, these conversational materials, provide us with a naturally occurring experiment. How do you know whether or not your explanation of a service is working? This mediator and many other mediators have a very similar kind of way of explaining mediation, which I would call a sort of philosophical or ideological explanation about the ethos of mediation. So we help people sort their own differences out. We don't take sides. It's voluntary. We don't judge. This kind of explanation. That's one way to do it. Another way to do it is a sort of process-oriented explanation. So we do this, we do that, then we do this, and this is how we go forward. So a procedural explanation of mediation. And the outcome of the sort of success or failure, the effectiveness or otherwise, of this encounter is going to be right in the interaction. You don't need anything else. You've got the kind of experiment right here. Because if the caller is going to go with this explanation, we should be able to see that happening at line 7. So at line 7, if the caller is enthusiastic, then we might get something like, great, that sounds just like what I need, or thank you very much, book me in, or tell me more. This is what happens at line 7. So a really sort of tumbleweed, dust bunny kind of silence at line seven. If 0.7 seconds of silence was enough to know that things between Dana and Gordon were probably rather doomed, then 2.5 seconds of silence here tells us that this is highly unlikely to be a positive response now forthcoming from the caller. So this is what the caller says in response.
Well, we quite honestly don't think she cooperates.
Here we can see that the mediator does not know their racetrack. They don't know, first of all, that this explanation of mediation to somebody who wants someone to be on their side as an advocate for them, constraining the behaviour of the vile neighbour next door, this isn't going to work. And yet, so many mediators explain the service in this way, not only in their initial calls, but also on their websites and leaflets and so on. So presumably the mediator thinks they're doing a good job, because they wouldn't presumably try to sell their service in a negative way, but they don't know their racetrack. And also they don't know that the most likely way out of the call from the caller is the other person won't. And there is a magic bullet that deals with this. It's a one-word magic bullet, which I'm not going to tell you now, but you can ask me about later if you want to. But one word will kind of fix this. But this mediator doesn't know the end of the race is nigh, and the caller is not going to become a client. These are the kinds of things that we can really get interested in as conversation analysts. We can zoom in on particular projects, on particular racetracks, whether that be mediators and clients or doctors and patients, and look at a particular question design, a way a request is done, and try and figure out what is effective and what is less effective. And so this is what I've been doing for the past 2 or 3 years, is evolving an approach to communication training. You can see how this work can underpin the basis of a really research-grounded training approach for practitioners. And I call it the Conversation Analytic Roleplay Method, or CARM, because the method works on the basis of presenting materials in the way that you've kind of been seeing already. So what you can do is do the research, find out how the interaction works on the particular racetrack you're interested in, and then find extracts of that where we see one outcome or another outcome, and then present to practitioners in real time, line by line, people doing the job they do, stopping it, getting them to think about what they might do next, and then seeing what the practitioner really did next and evaluating it. And this is how the method works. Let's go back to the racetrack. Conversation analysts can identify in slow motion, scientifically and systematically, how conversation works. We can often upend what we think we know about, say, how to build rapport or how body language works. One of the projects that we can zoom in on is the moment where people want to find out each other's relationship histories. And I've got this gorgeous example of a woman who is trying to figure out what relationship history the person sitting opposite her has had. And she starts to ask, haven't you ever been, and she stops, and then she says, have you been married? So she starts off asking a negative question. Haven't you ever been married? That's definitely a first mover kind of question. What do you mean, should I have been, and feeling defensive? But she stops herself and repairs, and we often do this in interaction. We'll sort of start something, stop it, and do something else. So she stops herself being a first mover and deletes the ever and the negative grammar, haven't you ever been married, to have you been married? And that's a much more positive question. So that's one thing you can do if you're a first mover. Try to stop yourself by asking positive rather than negative questions. If you are confronted regularly by first movers, what is it you actually do? What can you do to that? I think you take a leaf out of Gordon's book. Be nice in response, push back, and then hopefully you will teach the first mover something about what they're doing. And if you do both of those things, stop yourself from being a first mover and push back against the first mover, then hopefully your future racetracks will be smooth. Thank you.